Excellent. Okay. So again, my name is David Cheng. I am a spine physiatrist at USC Spine Center. Today, we're going to talk about spinal stenosis. I'll be in charge of the first section of our session today, and Dr. Wong is going to join us and talk about surgical options for spinal stenosis. A little bit about me. I joined USC 2 years ago, about 10 years into practice. I don't have any financial disclosures. I volunteer for several organizations listed here, including American Academy of Physical Medicine and Rehabilitation, NASS, and SIS. We have quite a varied audience joining us today, and but I imagine most of you on the call treat patients or have treated patients with lumbar spinal stenosis. And this, of course, is a condition where there's a narrowing of the spinal canal in the low back. Classic symptoms include back pain, leg heaviness with walking or neurogenic claudication. I've included here a cartoon of what a normal spinal canal is supposed to look like versus one with spinal stenosis. Spinal stenosis, of course, is a radiographic diagnosis. You know, not everybody who has this has symptoms. And for the purpose of today's talk, we're talking about symptomatic lumbar spinal stenosis with neurogenic claudication. Not surprisingly, the demographic that is most commonly afflicted with this problem is the elderly, so patients 60 years or older. I have listed relative stenosis and absolute stenosis, and we define that by radiographic measures, that relative stenosis is anything under a diameter of 12 millimeters and absolute stenosis of 10 millimeters. And this affects over 200,000 people in the US. And the natural history for someone with this type of problem is usually get insidious onset and kind of gradual progression. And this is such a common problem that it's the most common reason for a spine surgery in patients older than 65. So as part of my disclosure, I treat patients with this, but I have also been a patient suffering with spinal stenosis. So these are satchel and axial images of my low back in 2010. And you can see that what I had was an L4, L5, a disc herniation causing fairly substantial compression of the spinal canal. And the common symptoms for spinal stenosis, I checked off a few, and that's back pain and leg pain, leg cramping, some leg weakness and numbness. Obviously, the types of different types of pathologies that can contribute to spinal stenosis varies. For me, it was an acute disc herniation. So my history was a little bit different. It was not solely progressive. It was very acute and so very dramatic. Some important points on physical exam is that because these symptoms commonly present in the standing position or walking position, patients frequently have a normal neurologic exam. However, the symptoms have been ongoing for quite some time. We can see ankle weakness or weakness involving the fifth level in the low back, or L5. And the reason for that is L4, L5 spinal stenosis is the most common site. And as such, L5 nerve, if there is axonal loss, and we can see some ankle dorsiflexion weakness and great toe extension weakness. And I add a last point here to check distal pulses, because neurogenic claudication can sometimes look very similar to a vascular claudication. So this is, you know, one exam finding to look for to help distinguish between the two. The most common and most effective diagnostic test to determine spinal stenosis would be a lumbar MRI. The CT scan can also give clues to spinal stenosis. I've included an axial cut, a cross-section cut of the lumbar spine here to the right. And you can see that where the arrows are. The main arrow here points to the center of the spinal canal, and I would categorize this as advanced spinal stenosis. And in describing where the stenosis is, you know, right here in the center, that's obviously the central canal, and off to the side where these arrowheads are would be the lateral recess, and then all the way outside over here, this is the foraminal zone. So for the purpose of today's talk, we're talking about spinal stenosis centrally. There are a few things that we can see that are abnormal here. Number one is that there is a hint of congenital spinal stenosis, meaning that the spacing from here to here, the diameter of the spinal canal, looks narrow. Yet a quick and easy way to determine that is by looking at the width of the disc or the vertebral body. If we are seeing that this space is less than half of the vertebral body in terms of width, this can give you a sense of the likelihood of congenital spinal stenosis due to short pedicles. The second thing that we're seeing is thickening of the ligamentum flavum over here in the posterior aspect of the spinal canal. And lastly, of course, is the enlargement of the facet joints on both sides. On the left side, there is quite prominent fluid collection inside the joint or facet effusion. And we're also seeing synovial cysts arising from the facet joint here on the right side. We can see that this segment is likely in the lower segments in the lumbar spine, as you can see the orientation of the facet joints being more coronal. The last comment that I'll make is that there appears to be facet tropism, and that the appearance of angulation of facets are not exactly the same left versus the right side. I believe that Dr. Wang will be talking about this in his section as well. So we're going to move on to the next slide here. For the purpose of this section, we're just going to talk about interventional or injection treatments for spinal stenosis. Of course, there is lifestyle changes, physical therapy, bracing, and medication options that we won't talk about today. There are three main things that I will touch upon. The very first is the role of epidural steroid injections in spinal stenosis. And here, this is a cartoon of where this medication would be deposited. You can see that it is just anterior to the ligamentum flavum, and that is kind of the red, kind of marked by red over here. And this is the target for the injection through a midline or posterior approach. We're going to talk about different types of approaches in just a second. Epidural steroid injections are thought to act through several mechanisms, and a typical cocktail of injectate include a local anesthetic with a corticosteroid medication. And collectively, they're thought to wash out inflammatory chemicals or cytokines in the area. Number two, the steroid can suppress ectopic discharges. And it's also been known to increase blood flow to an ischemic area in the setting of severe compression. And lastly, it works through one of the postulated mechanisms of action of lysis of adhesions. I've included two fluoroscopic images here. A picture on the left side shows the intralaminar injection at the L4-L5 level. And so the picture on the right side is through a transfemoral approach, so coming from the side. And you are seeing that contrast going around the L5 pedicle in more cephalad. You can see that this over here, hopefully you can see my arrow here. This is entering the anterior epidural space versus the contrast kind of more midline here. There are three different approaches for epidural steroid injections. And one is from the side, that's a transfemoral approach. The second is an intralaminar approach, being between the lamina. And lastly, through the caudal approach and through the sacral hiatus. The two most common areas or two most common techniques are through the transfemoral approach or through the intralaminar approach. Caudal injections may be helpful if the pathology is at L5-S1, but because it's so far from the pathology above L5-S1, a high volume of medication is needed to reach the area. So this is a paper from 2014 by Dr. Freely out of University of Washington. Those of you on the call who perform or refer patients for epidural steroid injections, you may be very familiar with this paper. There was a one-year follow-up study from this kind of landmark study in New England Journal of Medicine published in 2017. And basically, it was a pragmatic randomized controlled trial comparing patients with lumbar spinal stenosis. Inclusion criteria is kind of patients with at least 3 months of symptoms with claudication symptoms, ages greater than 50. The two groups that were studied underwent either lidocaine injection alone versus lidocaine with steroid. Outcome measures included NRS for leg pain and also lumbar disability. At the end of 1 year, it was found that a third to half of these patients improved by at least 50% in leg pain. And if there was relief seen at 6 months, this relief may be maintained at 12 months. No difference was seen between the transfemoral or the interlaminar technique. There was a lot of kind of controversy after this study came out. And I think the takeaway, however, is that injection therapies, epidural steroid injections for spinal stenosis don't always work. The technique may not matter as long as the medication gets in the epidural space, and that lidocaine versus lidocaine and steroid may not make a huge difference. Conceptually, we've always recommended transfemoral epidural steroid injections as it has a more robust evidence. However, that is in the setting of single level low back pain and leg pain, so really in radiculitis. When we're treating spinal stenosis, I think it makes sense that whether we take a transfemoral approach versus an intralaminar approach, since the pathology is in the center, as long as the medication confidently gets in the epidural space, it doesn't matter. And that's kind of consistent with my experiences as well. So the take home here is that the procedural outcomes may not correlate with the degree of stenosis. Lumbar epidural steroid injections may be effective short term for a period of 8 weeks. And there is, however, limited evidence supporting long-term efficacy. I think that this is similar to how I counsel patients, that the two main things that I find to be most helpful in predicting whether the injection is going to be effective is the duration of symptoms and their standing and walking tolerance. And lastly, if they have had procedures in the past, their responses to the injection can also give us a clue in terms of future response. The second type of treatment that I like to talk about falls under the category of percutaneous image-guided lumbar decompression. Commercially, this is also known as mild or minimally invasive lumbar decompression. The cartoon here that you see shows us what this procedure is aimed to treat. It's aimed to treat primarily a patient with spinal stenosis due to, in large part, thickened ligamentum flavum. And so I'm going to talk to you a little bit about the mechanism of action here. So it's a direct decompression of ligamentum flavum. And this contributes to patients with these symptoms in upwards of 50 to 85% of patients in this category. And the procedure is done under a fluoroscopy. Primary indication that include subjects that are symptomatic from spinal stenosis, again, the neurogenic claudication symptoms, poor standing tolerance, poor walking tolerance with low back and leg pain. The most commonly affected levels are L3, L4, and L4, L5. The cutoff for when this treatment can be considered is the ligament being thicker than 2.5 millimeters. And so contraindications include prior surgery at this level. And the reason for that is in the initial stages of the procedure, an epidural steroid injection is performed, and that allows us to see kind of the patency or the lack thereof of the spinal canal. And so for that reason, the integrity of the ligamentum flavum is critical before the procedure can be started. And hence, if there was prior surgery at that level where the ligamentum flavum is disrupted, the interlaminar epidural steroid injections can't be performed safely. I'm just going to show you a few pictures of how the procedure is performed. Here you are seeing a fluoroscopic image where you see the spinal needle here. An epidural gram is created. You can see that there is a gap here showing that there is stenosis at this level. So proximal and distal to this level of compression, you can see the contrast. A cannula is advanced. And so here you are seeing a bone rondure here. The second step is the placement of a stabilized depth limiting portal. And the surgical instruments are placed within this portal, and the portal is used to make sure that there is no inadvertent anterior migration of these instruments. And the last stage is that through the cannula, a tissue sculptor is used to develop a thickened ligament, and the spinal needle remains in place, and contrast is injected after periodically, and expected is restoration of this epidural contrast, both up and down. And so after successful debulking has occurred, then you should see this versus this. Some important studies in support of this treatment comes from the Midas Encore study in 2018, and where 302 subjects were randomized to epidural steroid injections to this percutaneous image-guided lumbar decompression. And you can see that at year one, that this treatment was more effective than epidural steroid injections in both pain relief and disability. One thing to note, though, is that naturally there is some selection bias, potentially, as I imagine that most patients that would enroll in the study probably have not done very well with spinals with epidural steroid injections. If it worked well, they probably wouldn't enroll in the study. And also another thing to note is that success here is defined by NRS score improvement of greater than 2 and 10 percentage points in ODI. So you can see that for responders, the results were durable at 2 years. And for the study subjects, 5.6% proceeded for surgery. Safety is thought to be similar to lumbar epidural. There was no spinal instability that resulted as a result of this technique. One patient developed non-serious procedural hemorrhage that was treated with gel foam, and the patient was discharged same day. This is a case series from Cleveland Clinic, and it demonstrates some of the practical things that patients can expect from the procedure. 40 patients were selected consecutively, and it shows that the standing time improved from 8 minutes to 56 minutes. Walking distance went from less than one city block to 12 blocks, and mean VS score improved from 7 to 3.5. However, one thing that that's really important to know is that even though the indication for this surgery or for this procedure is a thickened ligament of greater than 2.5 millimeters. The inclusion criteria for this study was 4.0 millimeters. And so the mean pretreatment ligamentum flavum thickness was actually 7.1. So I think the takeaway here is that the treatment has a role, but the more strict we are in selecting patients for this procedure, the better the outcomes, potentially. So again, the mean pre-treatment ligamentum flavum thickening was 7.1 millimeters, which is quite substantial. This is a slide from the company Vertos, who produces the equipment for the procedure. And just want to make a few comments. So on this website, it mentions that the procedure removes the problem and leaves nothing behind. I think that is partially true. It removes the ligamentum flavum, but spinal stenosis oftentimes is a multifactorial problem. And so where there's disc pathology, facet pathology, those sort of things are not addressed. Another thing is that we're primarily talking about spinal stenosis centrally, and if there is lateral recess stenosis or foraminal stenosis, I imagine this treatment would not work nearly as well. This cartoon here on the right side comes from the MIS guidelines, and that stands for minimally invasive spine treatment guidelines, suggesting that mild should be considered after the epidural steroid injection fails. This is a little bit different than my own practice. We can kind of talk about my philosophy in just a second here. But one thing for all of us on the call to think about is, number one, does all surgery for spinal stenosis look like this? This, of course, shows us a decompression and posterior instrument effusion. And whether avoiding or delaying surgery is the goal, I think one concern that I have, and this is a concern that's shared by a lot of my patients with this problem who are elderly, is that, are we just postponing the inevitable? And if surgery is a corrective problem, a corrective solution, is that something that should be considered earlier on versus later? We are about 33 minutes into the hour, so I'm going to speed up a little bit so that we leave plenty of time for Dr. Wong and for discussion. The last treatment option is the interspinous process decompression. So in contrast to mild, this is indirect decompression. And so the idea is for interspinous process spacer to be placed at the index level. This limits lumbar hyperextension and also prevents ligamentum flavum buckling into the spinal canal. So in effect, it stretches out the ligament so it doesn't fold on into itself. It's not meant as a fusion, and range of motion is otherwise preserved. And if needed, the treatment is reversible. Patient selection should sound familiar. This is a moderate central canal stenosis with neurogenic claudication. Contraindications include more substantial spinal asthesis, severe scoliosis, and osteoporosis. The spacer is placed, again, between the spinous process. So if the bones are brittle, then it's not going to hold. The technique includes creating an incision, placing a dilator, and advancing it using a mallet. Cannula is inserted over the dilator. And then the interspinous gauge is inserted. And over here, we measure the interspinous space. And then we choose the correctly sized implant. Implant is then deployed. And then lastly, we confirm implant placement. Implants supersedes X-stop, which was on the market from 2005 and 2015. And it is one piece versus two pieces, and it's made of titanium alloy. X-stop was taken off the market due to the lack of the evidence supporting prolonged pain relief and also with a high rate of complications. Study in 2015, before X-stop was taken off the market, was a non-inferior study and basically compared X-stop to Superion, and it showed that both of these devices offered similar improvements in leg pain, back pain, and function. And this treatment effect is sustained at 2 weeks. If you look really closely here, that the reoperation or revision rate for the Superion from this study is actually slightly higher than the X-stop. And the numbers are 23.2% versus around 19%. The five-year data from this study, again, defines success as greater than 2 points out of 10 pain reduction. In using that metric, The success rate was 80% for leg pain, and back pain it was 65%. ODI improvement greater than 15% points is considered success. And so you can see the success rate there. A really important point, however, is to note the following things. Number one is that 25% of the patients that have undergone this implants required reoperation, and it wasn't specific in terms of what that reoperation consisted of. And this last number I think is really critical, which is that only 88 out of 190 subjects was included in the five-year analysis. So meaning all the data that we saw for success did not encompass everybody that had the treatment. So if we were to do an intention to treat analysis, I imagine the numbers would look a little bit different. This is my last slide. Take home point is that lumbar spinal stenosis with neurogenic claudication is a clinical and radiographic diagnosis. Epidural steroid injections are thought to offer short-term or intermediate pain relief. And for, in my practice, for suboptimal surgical candidates, percutaneous image-guided decompression can be considered for those who have stenosis due to ligamentum flavum thickening. And so the interspinous process decompression can be considered for those with central canal stenosis and foraminal stenosis in with low-grade spinal asthesis. And that's my